All right. Good evening, everybody. Good evening. If we could find our seats, and let me give a heads up to everybody outside. If your voice is too loud, it echoes very well in here. So just try to keep the tone down, even if you're outside. We want to be respectful of everybody here. We're all volunteers and public community members. So you know, if we have disagreements, let's keep them within our own heads for now. All right, good evening. Thank you for being here for our fifth Parks and Rec Community Bond Committee meeting. I am Brian Dillard. I'm the co-chair, or one of the co-chairs of the Parks and Rec Bond Committee, and my fellow co-chair is Luisa Caso. Before we get started, we do have an announcement regarding Spanish translation services or interpretation services.
Buenas tardes. Si alguien necesita servicios de traducción al español, puede pasar al vestíbulo y tomar audífonos para escuchar el programa de bonos 2017 en español. Gracias.
Okay, so we'll quickly go down the agenda here just to give everybody a heads up of what's going to happen. We're going to start off with a bond program overview by our city manager, Cheryl Scully. Then we'll jump into a discussion among the committee members. We'll receive comments from the bus tour. And then we'll go into, I think we have a portion in here where, yeah, we'll have a couple comments as well from Mike Frisbee's going to speak after the break. Okay. So after the bus tour comments, we'll get into a discussion about our proposals that we all presented at the last meeting. We'll kind of go through that list and review and see if we all have any changes from the bus tour and discussion among each other. So we'll jump into it with City Manager Cheryl Scully.
Good evening. I know this is our fifth meeting for the Parks Bond Committee, and I wanted to say on behalf of the City of San Antonio, thank you all for serving, for spending so much time deliberating and studying the staff recommendations and from hearing from the public. Each bond election, we make recommendations, host these committee meetings, and there's one committee that seems to rise to the top and have the most interest and attention, and that is the Parks Committee this year. And so we know that you have spent a tremendous amount of time and effort, and we want to sincerely say to you thank you for your time and effort because you are volunteers. So first and foremost, let me say that. Secondly, I just wanted to go back to what we talked about at that very first meeting when we considered some of the guiding principles and priorities that have been the council's direction to the committees as you consider the staff recommendations, which have not been made in isolation, but rather have been made in concert with our city council members, working with them on what is most important to them and what they have heard from the community. So our staff recommendations in large part reflect continuations of projects, consideration of those which perhaps were discussed in the last bond program, but for which we did not have enough funding to include them all, as well as those that meet some of the ideas that we talked about as part of the SA Tomorrow plan. So as you know, the mayor and council recently adopted a growth plan for the city, what we want the city to be over the next several decades. And so we're in the process now of beginning the implementation, and we want this 2017 bond program to enable us and help assist us in the development and implementation of that plan. Parks play a huge role in that, and over the past decade, we have doubled, more than doubled, the acreage of our park system. We believe that we were underparked, and so now we have more parks per capita than we had a decade ago, which is such a good thing affecting our quality of life. We also talked about, as part of the guiding principles, leveraging funds. So in those cases where we are able to secure private funding or funding through grants through the state or from the federal government or from nonprofit organizations, those partnerships are very important and are part of the decision making as to which projects we can move forward. Complete streets, investment in our major corridors, some of those issues, and the impact on our operating and maintenance budgets. Which projects have organizations that can help support those public spaces, those public green spaces. So I just reflect back to and refer you to those original guiding principles and some of the priorities that the City Council mentioned. Now, several of you have said, reflecting on your individual districts, that you're concerned that perhaps we need to do more in the individual districts as opposed to some citywide impactful projects. And let me share just a couple of numbers with you. So in the 15 years before 2005, I was appointed city manager in 2005, and one of the first things the mayor and council asked me to do was to work with them to develop a large bond program. The city had, prior to 2005, issued debt, voter-approved debt, in the range of $100 million to $140 million for the whole city about every 4 or 5 years. And so coming to this city and seeing how large it is geographically, we've now grown to 470 plus miles, square miles, I knew that number was small. And that's not to minimize $140 million, that's a lot of money, but to cover an entire city for streets and drainage and parks and facilities, fire stations and libraries, it doesn't go very far. So for the 15 years prior to 2005, the city issued $350 million in voter-approved debt. That's the total amount of general obligation bonds issued by the city from 1990 to 2005. Since then, with our two voter-approved bond programs and this one, so that would be from 2000, the 7 program, the 12 program, and what we're considering in the 2017 program, that will total $2 billion. So that 15 years from 90 to 2005, and with this 15 years, $2 billion. I mentioned that to you because we had so much catch-up to do. And in the 07 and 12 programs, we focused on so many needs throughout all the districts, streets and drainage and more fire stations and more branch libraries. And each time, we wanted to do citywide impactful projects, but we knew the needs were so great in the districts. Now with this $850 million program that we're able to recommend with no property tax rate increase, it's based on our growth and our good financial stewardship of the city. That is, we are cutting our expenses in every way possible so that we have that capacity to be able to issue debt to do the capital improvements we need in the community. We have an amount of money that enables us to not only take care of the needs within the districts, but also do some citywide impactful projects. And that's why you see more in this program. It's the largest in the city's history, but it enables us to do both, to take care of some of those district needs, but also to do some of the bigger initiatives. That's not to say that there still aren't needs. There always will be. I was at the site today with our police and fire personnel and city engineer on the infrastructure collapse where a person lost their life in that drainage situation. And so we know the needs are out there in the community to make improvements. Nonetheless, we're working at trying to seek a balance in what's in the best interest. And that's what we're doing all collectively. How do we take care of those individualized needs in the districts, but also be impactful and do some innovative, really creative kinds of projects? And some of those that we're considering, like Hemisphere, like Hardburger, like the South Side area around the missions to improve our World Heritage Site. Some of those projects are only possible because we have a larger program where we can devote some of our resources to individual projects and the big ones. So I just wanted to give you that context and let you know that it's, I know, tough decision-making that you have ahead of you, but we're here as a resource to help you in that process. And as I sit down, I'm going to call on our city attorney, Andy Segovia, who's just going to go over with you, if it's okay with the chairs, if Andy comes up and talks with you just for a moment about conflict of interest, because we've had a couple of questions from individuals, so we thought we'd just start off by explaining to you what that means, what the general rules are, rules of engagement, and then answer any questions that you have. Andy?
Once again, I also want to express my gratitude for all the members of the committee, the hard work you've done. I know this is your last meeting. A lot of hard work's gone into it, and we do appreciate all that you've been doing. As the city manager mentioned, there has been some questions that have come up on the application of what we went over at the beginning of the committee process in terms of the ethics principles. One thing to be mindful of is this is a committee that was formed to provide recommendations to the city council on what the specific projects would be recommended to that council. And the ethics principles were offered as guidance for you as members to help guide, conduct yourselves during that process. And remember, I said, you know, the aim of all those principles that we laid out was to make sure that it was a transparent process and a fair process. Some members of you, as most of you know, of the committee are volunteer members of various organizations that have a perspective or specialized knowledge about particular projects. And this perspective and this knowledge, I would think, is useful to the committee as you weigh the different projects that you're considering and what you're gonna ultimately recommend to the council. So we do not wanna undermine the ability of this committee to hear and consider those input from those committee members. Again, you were selected because you have some unique knowledge of your districts and you care about the projects in your districts. And obviously this committee and the council want your voices to be heard. And so to clarify on as you're going to start voting on specific things, we want to strongly recommend that if you're a committee member and if you're going to have direct monetary gain from any project, in other words, if you yourself are going to gain monetarily from a project, or if your employer is going to gain monetarily from a project, in other words, you're employed by a company that's going to get funds, we're going to ask you not to participate in the actual voting of any particular project as it relates to that. So I wanted to clarify that for the committee members. Again, you, in terms of whether you participate or not in any particular vote, we want you to be guided by the principles we talked about earlier, but probably more importantly, be guided by your own individual judgment and common sense as to what, again, what your purpose is here, what the context is, and again, we want to make sure that the objective is met, which is this committee and the council receive the full benefit of your input. So with that, thanks again.
Okay, thank you very much, Andy, and thank you very much, City Manager Scully. Any more? Ms. Scully, are you done? You're done, great, thank you for your comments. Next, we're going to move to item number three, the staff put together an incredible bus tour on Saturday, and there were, I believe, 21 members from the committee on the bus tour, which was an incredible number. We were very pleased with the turnout, although we would have liked to have had everybody there. We know that was not possible. Things come up and life happens. But nonetheless, we're happy to see as we went around the bus and took roll that we had at least one member, if not two, and sometimes a full house from each of the districts represented on the bus tour. And so I just wanted to review for those of you who were not there and for the benefit of the public, the projects that we went to visit, you can see them up there. We went to see Hemisphere Civic Park, San Pedro Creek, Old Spanish Trail, O.P. Schnabel Park, Harburger Park, McAllister Park, Brackenridge Park, Lockwood and Dingwiddie Parks as well. Unfortunately, because of the rain, we weren't able to jump out and put our feet on the ground, if you will, to several of them. But it really helped us understand also the importance of our work and our decisions and how it also chimes into the drainage systems as well. We saw them definitely quickly in action. We saw how the Parks Department works in very close coordination and why it's so important that a lot of these projects go forward, because drainage is a very important issue across the city. And with when we're under this type of weather conditions, the use of the parks as part of the drainage system becomes very important. And so that was certainly noted. You know, the civic parks add significant value to the quality of life, the wonderful quality of life that we have here. And I think because of the success of the parks, it's the reason why we have had so much interest at our meetings. And so I think it's really a hats off to the commitment that our community has had and the investment that we have made over the course of the years that we have made into our large regional parks, our civic parks, as well as the small pocket parks, because we've come to rely on them for what cities use parks for recreation, for access to health and wellness, and for social equity. And so when it comes to fighting for our parks, well, you know what, we get pretty excited about it, and that's what we've sensed here over the last several months. And it's wonderful to see everybody come out again for that. So we thought, those of us who were on the bus at the end of the day, that it would be a good opportunity for us to share some thoughts about what we saw, about what we experienced. And so I thought we would open up for discussion and spend a few minutes on that. So I'd like to open up, and we'll, in our normal fashion, Brian will take names and we'll raise our hands to be recognized. Yes, Doug, and then Melanie.
Well, let me say, I've been on a lot of parks tours, and every time I go, I learn something. So I think it was a very valuable experience. One of the things that I was struck by was this theme of connectivity, whether we're connecting Dingwiddie and Lockwood or the two halves of Harburger, or more importantly, connecting those parks to each other through a series of greenways. I thought was really fascinating.
Thank you, Doug. Melanie?
Thank you again for putting together the parks tour. Other than the weather, it was really fantastic to truly see the transition from urban to more suburban parks, like going when we started at Hemisphere Civic Park, seeing the complete change. And we learned that no one park is completely the same to their neighbor. And I think that was really fantastic to hear, because that's truly what you want in a city, is that you don't want to have to go to a cookie cutter park. You want a destination park in some cases. And so, especially yesterday when we got to see our city running through, with thousands of crazy people running through our city, 13.1, 5K, 6, or 26.2, we were able to actually pass by some of these. I counted 7 parks, probably in my delirium and not paying attention, but 7 parks. And to me, that is truly amazing that not one of them looked the same. And so I think that's one thing that we need to pay attention to when we're making these decisions, is that Doug is correct, that we are truly gifted that we live in this wonderful city, and that with one, when one of our parks fails, that means the next one doesn't get as strong. It just means that it's not brought up to the full potential that it could be.
Melanie, I think you're absolutely right. The issue of connectivity, that narrative that we've been talking about, really came to life as we were able to see. And when Xavier was, our parks director, was showing the map of the entire city, and you saw green space and how as we went to the outer parts of the community, green space became less and less. And that importance that we need to be mindful that as we have the opportunity to acquire land, that becomes very important to do so. Let's see, who is next, Brian?
Valeria, and then Charles.
Valeria, and then Charles, and then Rosa, and then Ms. Wilson, I think.
The tour overall was a positive experience, very eye-opening. It allowed us to envision the connectivity between the park system, which would be very unique to any city in this country, so it's a very positive thing. One of the things that I do want to address, though, is that we were asked to open our scope beyond our own districts, encompassing the entire vision of the growth of our city, specifically in the park system. I believe we have, and the tour allowed us to do just that. And I wanted to ask this of the rest of the committee, have you guys considered the neighborhood parks and needs? The tour, we never really went south or west of downtown, and it would have been nice to have seen those parks that are, that, you know, that they have very specific needs. And I just, you know, I wonder how many people outside of your own, how many of you guys have gone outside of your own scope of your own district to look at these parks in these neighborhoods on your own time? Even though we didn't vote to tour these specific parks, you know, we were asked to do the same, and we are communities and districts that really do have very specific needs, and the destinations for the community are these community parks. So we're talking about being destination, city of destination parks and all of that, but we really do still have to recognize that there is a need in these communities that we really have not really spoken about, because we have talked a lot about Hardburger, we've spoken a lot about McAllister and Hemisphere, and we have yet to address, I feel as a committee, the need of community equity. And I ask my community members if we could find some way to leverage that, because there is a lot of leveraging within the bigger projects. And in these communities, the leverage that we have are people leverage. You get people fundraising through plate sales and small fundraisers, which these communities will never ever see the scope and scale of money being invested. And these are just as important of investments in our city, because it is the infrastructure, and these communities were the communities that seeded the growth that we are now voting on for these bigger citywide projects today. So I just ask my community members to consider that, consider the parks that we didn't see, and the needs that the strength of our city is within the communities as well.
Thank you, Valeria. Charles? Charles, you're next.
Yes, first I'd just like to thank each committee member for their commitment. What I saw in the rain was a lot of committed people that was beyond the scope of what they're here for. And I know I've said some things about Hardburger Park. I was very surprised it was called Phil Hardburger Park. But I also learned some historical things that San Pedro Park, 1724, I mean, and some of the creekways, there were some things and opportunities of things that I didn't even know about. But one beautiful park I saw was the Old Spanish Trail. I believe that's what I saw, and how they are using the ecosystem and so forth, and also engaging the youth in the process. So I was very much passionate about that. But what I like to do now is also say, I want to withdraw our recommendation for District 2 to take $2 million from Hardburger Park, because we did have that conversation, Mr. Diller, that you told us to have with our council people and so forth. So our councilman wanted us to stay within our own parameter. So he's asked us to look at something within our own District 2 to draw from, and that would be the Botanical Gardens, and so for those other projects in our district. And I would, I know we're here and we want all our projects fulfilled, but we must do our own soul searching and must have a communication with our district person, because that's the ones ultimately going to make these decisions. And I guess we can save them a fight and media blitz if we do these things beforehand. So I would ask that that others join in what I'm doing. I do apologize to Hardburger Park. Yes, I did call the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers and TxDOT, and I wanted to make sure there was a opportunity not to shut down Wurzbach Parkway for 2 years and so forth. So I do apologize if you thought this is my way was an ugly way, but I do have a heart. Thank you.
Thank you, Charles. And so just from a process standpoint, and thank you for the follow-up. And yes, we encouraged each of the members and districts to talk to their council person and staff before the meeting so that we could go through and have some very good conversations here tonight about the proposals on the table. So what we'll do from a process standpoint is we're going to go through and we'll just double check and we'll make any changes to the proposal right after this part of the discussion. So let's see, Rosa is next. Yes, Rosa.
Good evening, everyone. Taking the tour for me was outstanding. I'm glad I took the tour. We are one city. We're one city. We're 10 committees or 10 districts. But what I learned on the tour, that we are all committed. I met new sisters and brothers that I'm facing you from across one another and not knowing the inner you. But that bus tour allowed us to really become that one. So I thank you for allowing me to serve on this committee. I see my councilman up there, amen, Alan Warwick. So I thank him for choosing me, I think. And everything that Charles said, we do rescind that proposal to take monies, that $2 million from Hartburger. Harbor, you are great people, great people. I did talk to the chair. My grandson is trying out for basketball tonight. I have been faithful, so I'm going to excuse myself. Amen. And I just told you all know I'm a bishop and a pastor, so I've been praying. So I've already prayed up that the rest of this session will go as planned. God bless you and keep you is my prayer.
Thank you, Rosa. Okay, Jeanette.
Thank you. I also benefited from this tour, and it became really apparent to me how important all of these parks are. I want to echo the city manager's comment about how these staff recommendations went through some scrutiny themselves. And so I have a question. It may be directed at staff, if I may. And I'd like to know if or what would happen to those projects that are within, let's say, the $250,000 range if they're not recommended to go forward.
So what happens is that we will consider them as part of the annual budgeting process. We have had an annual maintenance program for our park system where we try to accomplish some of the smaller projects, saving the bond program for the bigger, more impactful investments in the community. It's not a guarantee that each and every one of them will be funded, but we do have a multi-year program where we do study those smaller type projects that we can incorporate into the annual budget. I should mention too that if in the end you have one or two projects that you really wanted to fit into the program but cannot be funded, the committee can recommend to the council that if there are savings in the parks category that you recommend to the council that those one or two projects be considered next for funding. Okay? So that doesn't guarantee they will be done, but in 07, we saved $47 million in all the categories, and the council was able to go back to the bond committee recommendations and either expand scope of projects, maybe do an additional phase, or take on some additional parks or streets or drainage improvements. In 2012, the economy was much stronger, and we don't see those kinds of savings, but we are within budget. So in this next program, if there are savings, you do have that latitude to recommend that if there are savings, you'd like to recommend these additional one or two projects for consideration.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Okay, I believe that is, anybody else want to make any comments? Okay, so with that, thank you all very much for those of you who were able to attend. it was a great experience, truly. And I want to echo the comments about us coming together as one group. I truly, truly feel that it was extremely beneficial to be able to do that. So thank you again to the staff. I believe, Mike, how many other tours were going on at the same time? I think there were, how many committees? Four.
We have four total.
Four plus, yeah, so there were four committees, plus the Rock and Roll Marathon, plus another huge, I mean, there was just things going on throughout the entire city. So it was an incredible coming together, and the staff was phenomenal. So it was terrific to happen. So excellent. So now what we would like to do is, if you could, I'd like to pull your attention to the proposals that we had. I'm going to go through this sheet right here. Maria, so this is the sheet that you have in your packet. Let's see. Page 4 in your packet.
Attachment A.
And we would like to go through district by district. Brian, do you want to walk? You have it right there. We'll have Brian walk us through. And at this time, we'll go through district by district, any changes that you would like to have made to the proposals that you had.
So we'll start off with District 1. And if you look up here on the projector screen, it's also up there. And staff will be making changes as we go through. So at the last meeting, District 1 had made a proposal to move to defund $3 million from Hemisphere and fund $3 million to Old Spanish Trail. You know, leave that to District 1.
Does that stand? The question is, does that, are there any changes that we want to see to that proposal? If not, we will make the change, or we will keep it as is, or move on.
Co-chair, if I may, based on the information that we receive on the bus tour, there are some important projects like Civic Park at Hemisphere that if we don't get to $21 million, it's not going to happen. So I can tell you it's going to delay a lot of the things that we want to do downtown. So this is one of the projects that's why we asked that question about those small projects about 250, 295, 300,000, if they could be part of the process or part of the regular city budget. With that, there's at least 10 of those projects, could be about 2.5 million, 2.2. So based on that, if we could use those smaller projects into funding the Old Spanish Trails and put as much as we can from each of the committee members so we can get to Hemisphere to $21 million. So this is something that I'd like to hear.
Thank you. Hold on, please. Thank you all very much. This is a very complex conversation that we're having, and we need to understand what's happening. So thank you for your enthusiasm, but help us because we're needing to understand each other.
But I'm also very interested in hearing from all the committee members. I think that the group became very, very close on Saturday. My future recommendation to whoever is running this in the future, that we don't just have one bus tour, but potentially if we have 50 projects, split it over 3 Saturdays and go see every single project. I can tell you the project on the east side of those two parks being united makes a lot of sense. I mean, it's such a simple project of just doing the sidewalks and putting the trees and the grass and all that and make it bigger. So I like to hear from all the committee members, but this is something that we can put on hold until we figure out how to put enough money to make Civic Park happen. So I like to hear from all the other 9 district members here, but we will make changes to this because we were actually selected by a council member to take care of a specific project. So we basically have a responsibility to our councilman Roberto Trevino. So our interest is to put the majority of this money back, but we want to hear from everyone else first. And then if we can help a few other projects around the city, there are some that unfortunately, if you're going to build a sports park or a complex, if you don't put enough money, it's just not going to happen. It's not going to look completed. And that's the impression that I get by visiting a lot of other parks at my own time, There's a lot of parks that need a lot of help, but what has happened is just we have limited funds every year, and we got to take care of so many parks and the maintenance. I mean, that's another thing, that if you're building a park, who is going to take care of that? Don't expect the city parks and recreation to take care of all of this. There has to be a school districts involved. There has to be other nonprofit organizations like Civic Park and other groups like at Bracken Ridge. There's at least 5 different groups that can help on the maintenance. So we will probably put this on hold, hoping that the other members will put some money and help us to make Civic Park a reality.
Okay. Thank you, Marco. And just a reminder, these are proposals in this first round. We're going to recess and allow staff to reassess the situation and put it back up on the screen for us. And then we'll come back and we'll do all the motions the second time around. So what I understand is you wanted to reallocate the funding that you've already done. And then when we go around, if anybody wants to chip in on Old Spanish Trail with smaller projects.
Yeah, the solution, if we get to $21 million for Hemisphere Civic Park, we will be happy to help fund this other project, the Old Spanish Show. We just got to get there.
Okay.
And if everyone pitches in a little bit of money, we will get there.
Okay. Okay. So for okay. District 2, do you want to clarify? For District 2, the proposal was to pull $1,950,000 from Hardberger Park and allocate that throughout Dawson, MLK Plaza, and Pittman Sullivan.
That's correct. And our councilman has had a conversation with Mr. Rebart, and we've been addressed, and he wants to stay within our own lane. So we're moving that to the Botanical Gardens instead of Hardberger Park. And then we'd like to add the Dawson Dean Witte Hill piece, the $300,000 on the list that Ms. Scully spoke about.
Can
for
you,
District 2.
Can you restate that last part about the $300,000?
Yeah, if additional money is left over, we'd just like to add, not in this budget here, but if there's a list where monies were saved from 2012 bond or something like that, that they can use to allocate toward Dawson. That's in Dignity Witte Hill. It's a different Dawson.
Understood.
Okay. So to recap that, I just want to say that we would retract what we had said earlier about Hardberger Park, the $1.95 million, and we move that to the Botanical Gardens. I've already spoken with a young man representing Botanical Gardens. Okay. Okay, so we recognize that they have raised a lot of money, but this is a recommendation from the City Councilman District 2.
Understood. Thank you very much, Mr. English. So the last shift with District 3 was all within the district. You pulled $400,000 from World Heritage, which is a citywide 3 project, $800,000 from UIW, which is a citywide 3 project, and then allocated to Via Coronado, Jupe Manor, and then 5 Diamonds, which are all within District 3. Do you have any changes?
We have no changes.
Okay, thank you. Same thing with District 4. All of your changes were within your district. $100,000 from Miller's Pond and $30,000 from Spicewood. And then that you added those together and put $130,000 into Stablewood. Any changes?
Yes, there is a change. We're going to take the whole $130,000 from Miller's Pond, leave Spicewood alone with its $300,000, and give that $130,000 to Stablewood Farms Park.
Okay, awesome. Thank you. Mm-hmm. District 5, you had proposed to pull $2 million from Hemisphere, $1 million from Zoo Garage, and then allocate $2 million to the District 5 Parks package, and $1 million to Normal Senior, I think it's softball league.
According again to our city council person, we've been asked to fund as close to possible, fully fund Hemisphere Park. So we will need to take back the two or. Give back the $2 million. And I'd like to propose taking potentially an additional $1 million from the zoo garage. And an additional $1 million from UIW. And that would offset that $2 million. It's still going to go to the same people, the parks package and normal.
Thank you very much. District 6, your proposal was pull $3 million from Hemisphere and allocate $3 million to the skate park in District 6.
Sorry about that. Yeah, initially, actually, what we had up there was $4 million. We're not going to change that, but what we did have was $4 million for the skate park and $1.5 million for Piper's Meadow, and somehow that disappeared off of there. Piper's Meadow.
Okay.
So anyway, what we're looking at is the $3 million now for the skate park and $1.5 million for Piper's Meadow. Let me give you a little bit of an explanation there. This was not done lightly as far as Hemisphere. However, after the tour, I'm very impressed with the park, and I am certain that it will be funded. Not yet. $1,500,000 and skate park, $3 million.
So you're asking for an increase in $4.5 million.
Well, not an increase to $4.5 million for the skate park.
Okay.
$4.5 million from Hemisphere, $1.5 million for Piper's Meadow, and then skate park, $3 million. These projects, after our during the time frame of the meetings, these two projects came up. They cannot wait for another 5 years. The skate park is to break a cycle where we have kids today at risk going to skate parks unsupervised. They meet people with drugs, they meet graffiti. This is we have the people who have the vision today to put this park together. We have a location that's by a senior housing, YMCA, and a library, and tons of kids across the street. And I think we can break the cycle, and I think it's the time and the place for it to happen. The Piper's Meadow has a linear creek park running right by it. However, to go through it, they have to cross a number of streets to get to it. This is 700 plus homes, plus 7 apartment houses. This can be leveraged with the Ingram Park trailhead, which has a via bus section. So there's a lot of leveraging here. And again, we can't wait 5 years for that. And again, I don't ask lightly. I wish we could increase the budget. What we have done inside, which is not up there, we have 6 funded projects that we're going to reduce by 8% so that we can support an additional requirement that we have for one of our parks. They initially asked for $500,000. We're taking that down to $232,000. So you don't see that up there. I can give you a list. I don't know how to best to do that.
And these are new recommendations, new proposals.
They're new proposals.
Okay.
Right. But that leaves our money the same for our funded projects.
Okay. So you're wanting to shift from which parks to which park?
We have.
Because you mentioned 6 funded projects. Which, yes. 8% from which projects?
All of those 6 projects.
All okay.
Across the board. Yeah. Across the board.
Okay. All the ones that are currently.
Yes.
Yes.
So subtract 8%
from 8, except for North San Antonio Hills, and that is going to get that 8% added to it, and that will total 532.
A total of 532.
For that particular part.
Right. I'm looking at our budget.
Well, you don't have that up there.
You don't have it up there.
Well, she's making the changes live. So
can I hand her this?
Yes.
Yeah, that'd be good. So what project would be funded from the 6 that are being cut?
He's going to hand you the paper that he was working from.
Right.
And what will happen is
we did our own housekeeping before.
Yeah. We met this morning. I'm hard-headed, though.
Question? Do each of these recommendations take a vote from committee, or is this all going for our final recommendation? Like these proposals right here, District 6 is proposing all these, do we all get to vote on them as this individual proposal?
So we'll go through the motions on the second round to vote on each of these, yes ma'am.
Not as just one, okay, thank you.
Can we use this as, Xavier, can we use the, can we clarify this during cleanup time and reset time? And let's move on to District 7. Okay. District 7.
So District 7 recommended in the last one to move $1,350,000 from Botanical Gardens and also $2 million from Steubing Ranch. And they were going to take that $3.350 million and distribute it between Crystal Hills, District 7 Parks Package, Monticello, and then $2 million to Old Spanish Trail.
Thank you. We'd like to give back the $2 million to Steubing Ranch. We still want to keep Botanical Gardens at $1.35 million. We'd like to reduce Crystal Hills, or we'd like to rescind our proposal of Crystal Hills and CD7 Parks Package. We'd like to take $1 million from OP Schnabel to OST.
Okay, is that it?
Yeah. That's it for us, thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Actually, I don't have... District 8, you all didn't have a proposal last time, is that correct? Right, okay. District 9, your last proposal was $2 million.
Margaret, will you use your speaker, microphone?
I just wanted to say that the bus tour was great, and I did get to meet some wonderful people. And District 2, we are deeply grateful that the recognition of what's important is part of your the way you do your deal. So we're very grateful to you for that. And we do support the big community projects, and we're excited about getting this done. So thank you.
You're going to make me cry more. District 9, your proposal was to remove $2 million from OP Schnabel and allocate it towards Steubing Ranch.
Yes, and District 9 would like to rescind that request for $2 million from OP Schnabel. We'll leave things as they are.
So, no, okay, thank you. District 10, $1.5 million from Perrin Homestead, and you're moving that to Vital Creek Park, and that is an in-district move.
Before carrying out that recommendation, I would like if city staff could tell us a little bit more about Perrin Homestead. I hope that's okay.
No, it's fine. Well,
I would like to know more about what the project entails, what the $1.5 million goes to as far as the adapted uses, how far along in plans
Understood.
Those are in place.
Is that okay, Co-Chairs? So the city's in the process of purchasing the Perrin Homestead. We have a lot of history that's been out in the packets and follow-up items, so we're purchasing it with the intent that in the bond program, hopefully you all, the council, and the voters approve it, then we will... that will be an adaptive reuse. So it is a historic home on about 7 acres there, and we want to be able to it needs work inside to make it usable. And we want to open up for public programming, public activities around the facility inside. It's a beautiful old limestone historic site. So that's the intent, is to fully program that space inside and out. And that's what the bond dollars would go towards to get it ready.
Anything more specific in the plans for the future?
I don't know if I can get much more specific than that. There's going to be, it's going to be for full public use by multiple agencies, and I don't know if there's much more than that at this point. But
so not too many like laid out plans in place.
Right. So the again, the acquisition is occurring now, separate from the bond program. If it's not in the bond, that's going to be an issue because we won't be able to do much with it. We will have to look for funding to try to get it ready for public use.
As far as the Bidal Creek Park project, that's shovel ready, correct? As far as plans are?
I don't know for sure, actually. I believe that's a developer participant. Yeah. So I don't know the status of the design. That's a developer participation type agreement.
District 10 would like to propose, as opposed to taking 1.5 from Perrin Homestead, to divide the 1.5 million between the two projects, making it 750,000 to Perrin Homestead and 750,000 to Bidal Creek Park.
Thank you, Allison. Okay, let me see how we can do this here. Okay, so Marco had his hand up, and then we're going to jump over to Jacob, okay?
Yep, we have a joint conversation here with Sean. So what we would like to do, go back to District 1, and basically reduce the skate park, the $3 million, decrease that from the skate park. That could be achieved by the savings at the end of the bond, and they could be the first one on the priority list.
So the only thing with this is we haven't had, the skate park isn't funded.
Well, but someone put money to move them from another source, so.
We need to wait until the second round in order to do that.
Okay.
So can we hold on that proposal?
Yeah, we will also put the $3 million on Hemisphere from Old Spanish Trail right now, and we would like to add the $2 million left from Incarnate Word Sports Complex into Hemisphere also.
But the point is, we have current proposals that we've all been looking at, so we need to allow a reset of everything that's at the table, allow staff to take a look at it, then we're going to go around one more time and make some changes and then be able to vote.
I'll let Sean explain.
It's a sec.
We never completed. We were waiting for all the committee members to speak.
So you want to put it back to where it was, basically?
Yes.
Okay. So original proposal was $3 million from Hemisphere, and shift that over to Old Spanish Trail. Is that what you're proposing to go back to? Because you can't, so hang on. So the $4.5 million for the skate park was coming from Hemisphere. So in order to allocate the $3 million from that back to Hemisphere, that's, you know, we can do that all night.
Gotcha. So Brian, if I may, what we're looking to do, we want to make absolutely sure that Hemisphere is fully funded. So we want to keep that $21 million at Hemisphere, but we are sensitive to Old Spanish Trail soccer complex as well. So we're hoping that from the experience of the bus tour and with everything that was accomplished through that, as far as the unity, that as districts get together, we can do what we can to ensure that we also can allocate some funds towards the Old Spanish Trail soccer complex. I think our concern is that we want to work more towards things that's going to be completed. And we believe that Civic Park would be a completed project and going and off the docket, and then we can move on to look at other things. We're not interested in having fragmented themes all across the district. So just put very simple, $21 million back to Hemisphere, and then we'll see what we can do concerning Old Spanish Trail Soccer Complex, but we are on our hands and knees. I'm asking for assistance to fund that.
In reality, we want to put the $3 million on the Hemisphere back, zero on Old Spanish right now, and then we want to add the $2 million left right now from UIW, because you already took $800,000 out of it.
Co-chairs, if I may, we do understand that what we're proposing may be more of a second round type scenario. So we may be a bit premature in requesting that, but we're ready to make recommendations as needed once that second round begins. But to make it very clear, we do want to ensure that $21 million stays in Civic. And then as discussion opens up in the second round, we do have some proposals on how to have Old Spanish Trail Soccer Complex funded.
Understood, okay. Thank you, Sean and Marco. And I know you guys are kind of left in the wind here, depending on the rest of the committee. So I appreciate that. And let me get Jacob. Jacob was next, and then I'll get you over. Thank you.
We'll wait for round two. Sorry.
Okay, so what we're hearing is that we're gonna take a 15-minute recess. We are going to allow for staff to reset all of the numbers, go through and verify. There have some slides that they're going to adjust. Then we're going to come back and we're going to have them take a look and go through scope of impact. And then we will discuss as a group and make any other changes that we want to see and then begin on votes. All right.
Committee members, please talk to each other.